Hi, and welcome to 168 Kids. I'm Miss Liz, and I'm so glad you are here to learn with me. Do you remember a time when you ate a food that you didn't know what it was? Maybe your grown-up made a new dish for dinner, or you went to a friend's house and their family made food that was unfamiliar to you. Well, today, we are going to be talking about a time when a group of people called the Israelites were given food they had never seen before and didn't know what it was. If you have your Bible, open it to Exodus chapter 16 through 17 and follow along with me as I tell you the story. Moses led God's people from the Red Sea to the wilderness. They were hungry, so they complained to Moses. "We wish we had died in Egypt. At least there was food to eat," they said. "You brought us out here to starve." But Moses had not brought them out there to die. God was in control. God's glory appeared in a cloud, and God said to Moses, "I've heard the Israelites' complaints. Tell them, in the evening you will eat meat, and in the morning you will eat bread until you are full. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God." Sure enough, quail came into the camp in the evening. In the morning, fine flakes like frost were on the ground. "What is it?" the Israelites asked. Moses said, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat." The Israelites called the bread manna, which means, "What is it?" God told the people to collect just enough to eat for the day. If they collected too much, the leftovers would go bad. He told them to collect twice as much on the sixth day because the seventh day was the Sabbath, a day to rest. The Israelites did not always follow God's instructions. Sometimes they collected too much manna, and sometimes they tried to collect manna on the Sabbath day. God provided for his people, and he wanted them to trust him and obey him. The Israelites ate manna for 40 years, the whole time they were in the wilderness. The Israelites moved about the wilderness as God told them to do. One day, they came to a camp with no water. "Give us something to drink," they told Moses. "Why are you complaining to me?" Moses asked. The Israelites had forgotten that God was with them and had a plan for them. "You brought us out here to die," they said again. "Lord, what should I do?" Moses cried out. God showed Moses a rock and instructed him to hit it with his staff. Water came out of it and the people drank. It was a sign that the Lord was with them. God provided water and manna for his people's physical hunger. Later, God provided his son Jesus for our spiritual hunger. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life," John chapter 6, verse 35. The Israelites needed bread to live for a little while, but whoever has Jesus will live forever. Pray with me. Dear God, thank you for being a God whose word we can trust. When you make a promise to provide for us, we can believe that every day, God. Thank you for providing food for the Israelites, and thank you for providing Jesus to us. Amen. All right, now there's a few questions on the next slide that you can go ahead and talk with your family about. And if you click the link below, there are coloring pages and activity sheets for each grade level on our webpage if you'd like to learn more on your own or with your family. Thanks for joining me today, 168 Kids. See you next week. Thank you.
Thank you. Happy New Year, 168. Thanks for worshiping online with us. You know, this past week, I was told of a person that is highly immunocompromised, but has been worshiping with us through the live stream every Sunday without fail since our official launch in March 2021. Isn't that incredible? But since I don't want to point a spotlight on this person, but since we do care about them, I just want to take a moment to say we see you and we're sorry for the uniquely hard 2 years that you have had. But before we transition into some announcement slides and the rest of our gathering, I just want to provide two applications of hope and one word of thanks. Just first, if you're one of those folks who've been consistently tuning in or coming in person and call 168 home, would you consider joining in on a small group? We're relaunching our small groups in the next 2 weeks, and this would be a great time to jump back in or try a new group to find hope as we journey together and not alone. There'll be an announcement slide with more details coming up on the stream. Second, I want to not only grieve the past 2 years, but hold on to the tension of the incredible advancements we've made in battling the pandemic and urge us to hold on to hope. As you know, through the past 2 years, we now have access to antibody treatments, effective vaccines and boosters. There have been recently approved antiviral pills that can be taken at home, accurate testing, and we just have more knowledge about effective treatment and preventative measures. There's a guy named Dr. Ashish Jha. He's the Dean of Brown University Public Health. He said this week. Let me read it for you. "This isn't the holiday season that we had wished for, but it needn't be anything like the fearful and isolated winter a year ago. Omicron spread makes a surge of infections inevitable, but the impact of those infections depends on the steps that we take over the next few weeks. But with the tools and strategies described above, we can meet the challenges of this latest variant, protecting our hospitals, allowing schools to remain open safely, keeping open the businesses, theaters, and churches," that's my insert, "and more that enrich our lives and sustain our communities. This year can be the year we get the pandemic under control." And for that, I urge you not to lose hope. I have real hope for this year, 2022, as we continue to work together. We can do this. Finally, can you just type in the chat? That's right, type in the chat some names of essential frontline workers that you are committed to praying for and thinking about right now. Let's encourage them, as some of them had to forgo their Christmas and New Year's gatherings to fight the surge. And here are just a few occupational categories to spark your thinking as you're writing, as you're typing. When you think of our healthcare workers, not only doctors and nurses, but mental health specialists, social workers, kidney dialysis center workers, teachers, also those who work in residential care facilities, our first responders, those who work in our correctional facilities, and our transit services. Thank you. We see you and we are praying for you. Hey, wherever you are, would you just bow your heads, close your eyes, and join me in prayer before we enter into time of worship? Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that in this moment that we get to call you Father, that we get to come before you as sons and daughters, not because anything we have done, but because of your goodness and your mercy and your love for us. God, I ask that as we continue to participate through this forum, that you would use a time of worship, that you'd use a time of the word, that you'd even use a time of the live prayer and lobby after the message to encourage, to build up, and to bring about new hope to those who are engaging. God, thank you for loving us. Thank you that in you we find hope. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Under your wings, You are peace to a restless soul. we're going to sing a new song today. It's called God, I Look to You. And Psalm 121 says, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. So no matter what sort of year you've had, let's look to a sovereign God who reigns above all else.
God, I look to you, I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. And God, I look to you, you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. And God, I look to you, I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. And God, I look to you, you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength, and I will love you, Lord, my shield, and I will love you, Lord, my rock, forever all my days, and I will love you, God. God, I look to you, I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. And God, I look to you, you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock, forever all my days. And I will love you, God. Sing hallelujah. And hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days. And hallelujah, sing hallelujah. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns forever all my days. Hallelujah.
And thank you to the worship team, and just thank you so much for choosing to worship with us today. We're so grateful that you're here. Man, the last couple of years have been a rough journey for all of us, and even today, we didn't plan on starting our first year online, but here we are. But I'm here to tell you, welcome to 2022. It is a new year. And it is a great time for me. It is where I like to reminisce about my honeymoon with my wife because it was our first trip together. It had a lot of memories, but one that actually stood out to me this year was we were waiting in the Pacific Ocean, and we were out a little farther than I like to be, you know, the kind where you're jumping over the waves and your feet aren't touching the ground. And so I remember being out there, I had my sunglasses on, and we were having a great time. I'm a little nervous, but I'm with my wife, and all of a sudden, I just remember this wave picking me up and sweeping my feet from underneath me, and it slams me to the ocean floor. And I remember struggling with every muscle in my being, trying to get to the top, trying to push myself above the wave and feeling like I just was never going to make it back up, gasping for breath. And finally, I pushed through the surface. I felt the sun and I had that big breath in. And I remember the joy and the peace that I felt in that moment because I was finally free from the grip of the wave. I mean, the joy that I felt because I was alive, and it was this joy that just surpassed all other states of being I had ever been in. I mean, in a similar way in your life, do you feel like you are struggling in your marriage? Are you struggling at work? Are you struggling to reconcile a relationship? Maybe you're struggling to find employment, or maybe you're just struggling with the ever-changing regulations that are going on in the world around us. Or maybe you just feel so restrained, but you're on the verge of a breakthrough, but just can't break that bubble. And you're honestly just looking for relief and hope in this life. I mean, are you looking for that hope and that peace that surpasses all understanding? I mean, honestly, have you spent the last 2 years looking for this hope and peace in your life? I mean, are you looking for a sense of freedom in your life? Well, I'll tell you one thing that I know that God desires freedom for you. And honestly, that leads us to our main idea today is this: God desires for you to live in the freedom that Jesus provided through his death and resurrection. So if you're with me, you're still tracking, open your Bible to John 8:36. That's John 8:36. And it simply says this, it says, "So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." And I love these words because these are the words of Jesus Christ as a way of assuring those who believe that he is the Son of God and the prophesied Savior of the world, that they have been made free and that no one can take their freedom away from them. I mean, Jesus is the only way to experience genuine freedom. Okay, I mean, think about this. Maybe we talk about struggling with our marriage, or you're struggling with your job or a family or a friend or with the world, or just maybe all the events that have happened over the last 2 years, or maybe just emotional or past trauma in your life. Like, listen to me. Like, Jesus has provided you with freedom. Jesus has given you the opportunity to experience joy, peace, and hope in your life, no matter what you are experiencing or will experience in the future. I mean, Jesus has provided the way, but it's up to you to choose him. I mean, just a few verses above verse 36, Jesus tells us exactly how we can attain this freedom through him and him alone. So back to your Bible, scroll up to verse 31. So John 8, 31 and 32. And Jesus is talking to his, he's telling the people right now, he's saying, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." I want to focus on three words out of these verses: teachings, truth, and freedom. When I think of those three words, I think of this analogy that is commonly used, and it simply says, you can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make him drink. Now, what I think about when I think about this, I think about Jesus. Like, Jesus came to open the door to eternity for us. He opened that door, and through the leading and the prompting of the Holy Spirit, we are led down the path that leads to eternal life. See, the horse being led to water, we've been led to the path of eternal life by the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. The second thing is we have the responsibility to not only walk the path of righteousness that leads to eternal life, but we must live our lives with the firm belief that Jesus is the Savior. And we have to obey and understand the leading and the prompting of the Holy Spirit is trustworthy and truthful. And lastly, we have to, the way we do this, we have to study the teachings of Jesus and become more aware of the Holy Spirit, as well as obey the leading and the prompting of the Holy Spirit, because this leads to that life in the freedom of Christ that he has provided for us. Listen to me. Christ desires us to live in the freedom that he has provided for us. But in order to live in this freedom, we need to evaluate our lives. We need to rethink what we prioritize in our lives. And one question that has really just been on my heart as we head into 2022 is, and I want to ask you this, are you living out your faith as a loving and worshipful response to Christ's love for you? So simply ask yourself this question, are you living out your faith as a loving and worshipful response to Christ's love for you? I mean, allow your response to this question to determine what your next step on your faith journey is. I mean, allow your real and honest response to this question to help you understand what is the next pillar of faith that I need to put along this journey of faith that I have. And that brings me to this, like, listen to this. This is my challenge for you this year. No matter where you're at in your faith journey, make this a pillar year for you in your faith journey. Make this a pillar year. And I picked the word pillar because a pillar by definition is a source of strength. It can be defined as a rock or a tower of strength or even a guide. And I love the idea of placing pillars in our lives along our faith journeys, because when we get in rough spots in our lives, we can reflect and we can look back and see the pillars in our lives where God has come through over and over and over and over again. And if you're unfamiliar with who God is, you can look back when you learn him and you put your faith in him, you can look back and see that was God the whole time putting those pillars up in your life to show you who he is. I mean, these pillars, when you look back, will serve as a place of strength. They will serve as a guide for your life. So I simply ask you, as we round out our messages, what pillar do you need to place in your life this year? I mean, is this the year that you place the pillar of salvation in your life? Is this the year that you place your faith in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone as your Lord and Savior? Is this that year? Is that the pillar that you're putting up? Or maybe you've been walking with Christ for a little bit. Maybe you're new to the faith, or maybe you have done that. Then is this the year that you make your faith journey your own? And what I mean by that is, this the year you learn how to study God's word. You learn how to pull what God is trying to say to you out of the text. You learn how to study the text, and you learn how to apply that to your life. You know, when you make your faith your own thing, is it the year you need to serve God and step up and serve God with your talents and your time and your finances? Is that the block? Maybe the block is you need to step up on a team and you need to serve on a team. Or maybe that is like, hey, God, this year I'm going to be committed 52 weeks a year, 12 months this year. I'm going to be committed in my finances to all the ways that you're calling me to. Or maybe this is the year when you make your faith journey your own, that you begin to understand and obey the call that God has on your life. And I'm going to give you a little hint there, like, to understand that call that God has in your life, if you're in that step, you have to become more aware of the Holy Spirit. Like, God uses the Holy Spirit to illuminate what he has for you in your life. And there's one more pillar. Maybe this is a year that you put the pillar up of actively growing in your faith. And the question I want to ask you on that is, are you pushing yourself beyond your comfort zone in your faith journey? I mean, are you rethinking and challenging what you think you know and what you believe, and allowing God's truth to continue to grow within you and saturate within your life and grow in knowledge in you? Are you pushing yourself to maybe reconcile with people and reconcile relationships, or maybe even reconcile with the history of this country, or maybe simply just reconciling with the church? I mean, the second piece of actively growing your faith is this. Are you journeying with others in this life? Honestly, the question is, are you being held accountable? Are you being discipled as well as discipling other people? So are you living life with one another? And are you having people live life with you? I mean, for those who have been walking in faith for a long time, are you actually raising up or helping to raise up the next generation of leaders? I mean, here is my challenge for you in 2022. Make this year a pillar year in your faith journey. Lord, we come to you, God. We're so just grateful. God, we pray that this year would be a pillar year, God. May we find strength in who you are. Lord, I don't know where people are at or on that are listening right now, God, but I pray that whatever pillar you're calling them to put into their life and their faith journey, God, that they would step up and that they would put that pillar in and they would trust all the ways that you're going to come through for them this year. Lord, we pray for 2022, God, may it be a year that is filled with joy, peace, and hope for all of us. God, may it be a growth year for all of us. Lord, we are so grateful for all the ways that you've come through for us over the over our lifetime. God, we're grateful for your love, your grace, and your mercy in our lives. God, we give all that we are worried about this year to you right now. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. All right, well, please turn your attention to the screen for some exciting announcements. Following the announcements, we'll have the link to our live prayer and lobby. And you don't want to miss this because we'll be playing a game in our live lobby. Don't miss that. But as we said earlier, we know the holiday season and COVID can be tough. But we don't want you to journey alone. We want to do it together. So right now, head over with me to our live lobby and for live prayer. I will see you there.